Praise when I'm sure. Praise when I'm doubting. Praise when outnumbered. Praise when surrounded. My praise is the one. My enemy's drowning. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. Cause I know you're still in control. Cause my praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. My praise is a shout that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. You reign, praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise cause you're sovereign, praise cause you reign. Praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's no. Come this morning ready to praise the Lord. Amen. This is Palm Sunday, a Sunday when people gathered as Jesus entered into Jerusalem and they waved palm branches and they were excited and they praised the Lord. And I feel like that song that we just sang is kind of a similar expression to what they would have had. But the important thing is not what we do on the outside. The important thing is what we're doing on the inside, right? And so this morning, I just want to invite you to be reminded that Jesus is our King. They thought he was an earthly king, but we know he's the King over all of creation. And so how much more should we praise and worship him this morning? Amen?
Clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down. Every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. Who can stop the Lord? Power and fighting our battles. slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him.
Yes, Lord, we worship You, God. We bow before You, Lord. You are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Praise Your name.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself and carried the cross. Love is so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names. Blessed is from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, His blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. Lord of all. ransom from heaven. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
Yes, Lord.
Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
Yes, Lord. You worship you, O God. You are the anointed one of God, King of kings. You came for us, Lord. We worship.
Feel the world is broken.
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
But you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through.
We do.
Do you wish that we could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? To ransom the slave, is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? Yeah. Thank you. King of glory.
I will follow you.
we just praise God, church, together this morning. God, we thank you. God, we thank you that you give life and life abundant, Lord. God, that there is nothing this earth can give that would satisfy compared to following you, compared to knowing you, oh God. God, that nothing could measure up, nothing could come close to knowing you, to loving you, to following you, Jesus, the King of Kings, God, King over everything, God, the Lord of Lords. God, we thank you. God, as we enter into Holy Week, Lord, and it's Palm Sunday, and we look ahead knowing that you are risen, God, that you are alive. God, we thank you for the work of the cross. God, we thank you for your blood that was shed in a mere 5 days, Lord. God, and we recognize that it was only because of you that we have been saved. And so, God, we thank you for the gift of salvation that you have so freely given us, Lord. God, we praise you. We thank you, Lord. God, we thank you that because of the work on the cross, Lord, that you forever reign. God, you forever reign. You reign over sickness, Lord. God, you reign over poverty. Lord, you reign over war, over hatred. Lord, you are a God who is above all things, oh God. God, there is nothing that you cannot do, Lord. So God, I just specifically lift up the needs of our church here, Lord. You know each person in this room, Lord, and watching online, oh God, and you know the needs that they are facing, oh God, whether that is through healing, Lord, or maybe they need employment, God, and they need doors to open, Lord, to provide for their families, God. Lord, maybe they're in need of reconciliation in their relationships with their spouse or their colleagues or their children, oh God. God, we ask that you would intercede in these situations, Lord. God, that you would reveal yourself. God, that you would give us wisdom and a sensitivity to your spirit, Lord, as we strive to follow you and live for you. And God, we specifically lift up Kostin, a member of our church, where we lift up his sister, Vanessa, who is currently in surgery right now, getting a brain tumor removed, oh God. And God, we ask that you would be with her in this procedure, oh God. God, we thank you that you are our healer, God. God, that all sickness bows at your feet, oh God. And so, God, we ask that the surgery would be successful in Jesus' name. God, that the tumor would be successfully removed, oh God, that there would be no damages to her brain post-surgery, post-op, Lord. God, we ask for a speedy recovery, Lord, and even just for a miracle, God, because we know that you can do the impossible, Lord. What the doctors say are impossible, God, we know are possible for you. And so, God, we ask that you would touch her body, oh God. God, that the cancer would leave in Jesus' name, that there would be nothing that comes up post-surgery, Lord. God, that she would be able to walk in the freedom of the healing that you provide, oh God. And so, God, we ask that you would comfort her, her family, Kostin, oh Lord, and his family, God, as they walk through this, Lord. I mean, God, we ask that you would provide them with your peace, oh Lord, and that you would continue to draw them close to you in the days to come. And Lord, we also lift up Shirley Snow, a member of our church as well, Lord, who is currently facing an infection, oh God. And God, we know that you are capable of healing. And so God, we ask that you would be with her, Lord, as she recovers, God. We ask for a speedy recovery in Jesus' name. And God, that there would be no more infections or and illnesses, God, that arise, and that she would be able to be 100% recovered, Lord, and that it would amaze the doctors, oh God, and that she would be able to witness of the goodness of God in her life in this way. And so, God, we thank you for all that you are doing, Lord, and all that you are. God, we praise you for the fact that you are not just our friend, Lord, not just our Savior, but you're also our Father, oh God. God, that you care so deeply for us, Lord. God, that we are your children. And God, that you love us so profoundly, Lord, that there is no other love that can compare to you. So God, as we as we continue in this service this morning, Lord, and we take the time to learn about you, God, we ask that you would open our hearts. Holy Spirit, would you give us the ears to hear what you are saying this morning, Lord? God, that we would be attentive to your voice, oh God, and that we would be obedient to follow as you lead us, oh God. God, we love you and we thank you. In your holy name, amen. Amen. Good morning, church. Good morning. Happy Palm Sunday. It's so amazing to be with you. You may be seated. If you are a child age 3 to grade 5, I know some of them are running downstairs already. You can go down with Pastor Faith Ann. If you're in grade 6, it is Youth Alpha this Sunday morning. So you can go downstairs. Leader Luke and Leader Paul will meet you downstairs for Youth Alpha. I'm going to pass it over to Pastor Jay for our announcements this morning.
If you are a guest with us, we hope that you will take a moment to fill out the QR or to take a picture of the QR code from your smartphone, and that enables you to do several things. You can fill out a Connect card that lets you know us know a little bit about you, and we'll reach out and answer any questions that you might have about the church. And there's ways to give there. There's event registration when we have events that are upcoming. So it's a great way to kind of get to where you need to go here at SSCC. If you prefer the paper method, there is at the back, just to the right side of the door, double doors, there's an offering box there, and there's guest registration cards, and you can fill it out and just stick it in the offering box, and that will get to us, and we'll also follow up with you. Today, following the service, all official members, whether you've pre-registered or not, you're welcome to come, and just plan to stay following the service. And as a reminder, there's no cafe today because of that, because most of the cafe workers are members, and so there won't be a cafe following the service today. I hope that as many of you who can will plan to join us this Friday at 10:30 a.m. on Good Friday, where we celebrate and remember what Jesus did for us on the cross. And this service will be a great place to bring friends who maybe are open to spirituality, open to the truth, but haven't yet decided on Jesus. And so I want to encourage you, both Good Friday, Easter Sunday, we know that this is a time of year when some people who otherwise would never darken the door of the church will say yes to an invitation. And so I hope that you will plan to invite someone and that they'll come. And this might be the opportunity for them either to have a seed sown in their life that will reap later, or even for people to come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior right here Friday and Sunday at 10:30 a.m. I will also just mention that we will have nursery available, even though this is the last Sunday of the month for Easter Sunday. We will have nursery available. We are working really hard at getting every week nursery. We have a few people coming through the pipeline, doing their background checks and that kind of thing. And so if you are able to help us, we are short at least one worker to be able to go full-time every week nursery. And so if you would do that, we want to make sure that we don't burn anyone out. And so we're just scheduling people once a month. And so do speak to either Pastor Faith Ann or Pastor Chantelle after the service if that is you, or shoot us an email at info@sscclife.ca. Samantha Ritters is coming to bring a special announcement for the ladies.
Good morning, church. So like Pastor Jay said, this announcement is for the ladies. We are having our intergenerational ladies tea on April 13th at 1:30 to 3:30 p.m. This event is for ladies of all ages, so I really encourage you to bring your daughters, your granddaughters, your nieces, your cousins, your aunts, your sisters, your mothers, your grandmothers. Ladies of all ages are welcome. Sign up is required, and we do ask that you let us know how many people that you're bringing with you. It just helps us to prepare for everybody that's there. Sign up will be open today, as of today, in the back after the service. You will see on the sign up sheet that there's 5 different categories of food to bring. So there's sandwiches, hot hors d'oeuvres, which can be things like quiches or mini sausage rolls, cold hors d'oeuvres, which can be things like crackers, fruits, vegetables, There's also going to be desserts, tarts, cupcakes, squares, and then scones. Did I forget one? No, I think I'm good. Okay. We also encourage you, if you want, you can bring your own favorite tea or coffee cup. Everybody enjoys having a nice cup of tea and coffee in their favorite cup, and it's a great conversation starter. So this is just a great time for women to come together and connect and talk, and so we really hope to see you there on April 13th at 1:30.
Before you go, can I give you those to put somewhere? Okay. Samantha's holding what my next announcement is about, and these are sunglasses, but special sunglasses. Most of you know the eclipse is coming up on April the 8th, and I'm a little bit of a science nerd. No donation money was spent on these. I paid for it myself. But I know that some of you have kids who are getting free glasses, and you might want to take advantage of this opportunity to talk about God's great creation. He made an amazing system, and the solar system and how the moon works with the tides and all of that and supports so much of the life. And part of that is the eclipses. If the moon was just a little bit further away, we wouldn't have eclipses. If it was close, too close, well, we'd have other problems, but we would have super eclipses, you could say, and it's just in the right spot to cover up the sun and just leave that little aurora around it. There's lots of internet resources about how you can use these safely. These came directly from the U.S., I forget what it is, geological something or other, or astronomical, sorry, they're wrong science. Society, it's certified, they're safe to look directly at the sun any day, but they will help you during an eclipse. There is a moment where you can take them off, but it's a brief moment when you have the total eclipse. And I'll let you look up the directions for that. But this is a great teaching moment for your kids. And even if you don't have kids at home, they're there. I don't have maybe enough for every single person, but when they run out, they run out. So don't run back now, but at the end of the service, we'll probably just put them... Okay, see Francis. He will be at the back with those. Am I causing a marital breakdown there? No. She volunteered him, you know. That's what that happens in some marriages. So just make sure that they're happy there. That's good.
Awesome. So what is the craziest thing you have ever seen people line up for? You don't have to shout it out. Maybe you need to think it in your head. When I was growing up, my dad grew up in the 50s and 60s, so he would talk a lot about Beatlemania and the hordes of young women who would chase around the Beatles in the streets. My parents would talk a lot about people who would line up for the newest electronics. When I think in like the early 90s, in the 1990s, my dad told me of a story where he had lined up overnight for a new film camera that was being released, and he lined up, and they said like the first 10 people would get a gift card. There are so many things that people line up for, and one thing that has always fascinated me about people who kind of have these crazy obsessions, and whether it's lining up for a new product or lining up for a celebrity or lining up for a good deal on Black Friday or Boxing Day. One thing that has always fascinated me is people's obsessions with celebrities. Maybe you have had similar fascinations, or maybe you're just like, what do people do? Why are they so obsessed with these celebrities? Whether it's people lining up for maybe the presidential inauguration, waiting in the rain and the cold just to hear the president speak and to address his country. Or even this summer, there were crowds of fans of Taylor Swift who did not even have tickets to her concert. And there was something called Taygating, so Taylorgating, where they would line up in hordes outside of the stadium just to hear her sing through the roof of the stadium because they couldn't afford tickets to get in to the actual concert. And there would be thousands of girls and their moms and their friends lining up outside of these large stadiums to hear her sing. I was not one of them that lined up outside. I actually was lucky enough to get a ticket to see her in concert. But it was crazy. There was 50,000 people, 50,000 people at the show that I went to in Detroit. And I've never seen a crowd that large, especially for a concert, for just one girl. Or even when Queen Elizabeth, when she passed away, the media reported that people lined up for days in order to say their goodbyes to her at her memorial. They lined up in the cold, in the rain, and they waited just to see her coffin and to just thank her for her service. Celebrities and famous people alike attract large swarms of people who follow them around. People who are obsessed with what they're doing. Maybe you see your teenagers doing this at home, talking about the newest celebrity and what clothes they wear, if they cut their hair, what restaurants they like to go to. And I was definitely one of these teenage girls who was obsessed with celebrities. And so when I grew up as a teen, I grew up in just outside of Toronto, so around like a 40-minute train ride into the city. And there was this thing called the Much Music Video Awards. Maybe you're familiar with it, but it was this music award show for a bunch of celebrities who would come into Toronto for this award show. They would perform and give speeches, kind of like the Grammys, but a much smaller version of it. And my friend and I were like, we want to go. They had this opportunity for girls or guys to line up for the red carpet to get the chance of maybe meeting their celebrity that they loved. And so my friend and I, like, we have to go. We have to do this. And so a week before the award show, we were told by the production team that we had to go into Toronto and line up outside to get these wristbands. And so we go after school, her dad drives us in, we line up for 4 hours just to get a wristband that will let us into the queue to wait for the red carpet the week later. So we get our wristband, a week passes by, it is now the day of the award show, and my friend is kind of giving me the game plan because she's done it before, and she says it's really intense. And so she's like, we have to wake up at 4 a.m. to get to the 5 a.m. train, and then we'll get into the city at 6 a.m., and from there, we have to walk all the way to the street where the award show is happening. And then we're going to line up and wait. And I was like, well, how long are we going to wait for? She's like, till 8 p.m. And so I was like, okay, that sounds reasonable. And so I was 16, and I woke up at 4 in the morning, packed my backpack with a couple snacks and a water bottle and a phone charger, hopped on the train, got into the city. And we showed them our wristbands, and they said, okay, wait here in this line. And it was on, if you've been to Toronto, it's on Queen Street. And so we are waiting on this street. It's now 6:30 in the morning, and we're just standing there. And it's the middle of June. Like, it's end of June. It's super hot. The sun is beating down on us. I didn't wear sunscreen. And we're just standing there. And as we stand there, we're towards the front of the line, and then the crowd just starts to grow and grow. And the line gets longer and longer that it's running around the block. And the police had to block off the entirety of a couple blocks because there was just teenage girls lining up for this award show. And so we're lining up, and you can't leave. You can't leave to go to the bathroom. You can't leave to go get lunch or go get snacks because you'll lose your place in line. So you have to stay in line and wait until they open up the doors to the red carpet. And so they would have these people who would come by, and they would give us advertisements of like, oh, here, try this new cream cheese cup, and here's a lip gloss for you to try, just to kind of like satisfy how long you were waiting for. And finally, it hits 5 p.m., and they're like, the line starts to move. And we're like, this is exciting, the line is moving, it means we're getting close. And they're like, okay, you're gonna move from here, and you're gonna now line up over here. And so they have us all move to another queue to line up in, and now we're waiting, and then it's finally like an hour before the celebrities get onto the red carpet, and they're like, okay, we're only gonna let in around 150 people onto the red carpet. And so I was like, oh man, she's right. It's really good that we came at 5 in the morning for this, because there was like at least like 700 people in line. And so I was like, that's great. We're in the top 150 people. And so we get in, and they're like, okay, here's the red carpet. And they had these barricades that lined up on the red carpet so that you couldn't like actually jump over and touch the celebrities. And so we line up and we're pushing and we finally get to the barricade and I grab onto the barricade and I'm like, we did it. We're gonna see the celebrities. And I had come there for a couple celebrities. Specifically, as you can see, the Jonas Brothers were there. And if you're familiar with One Direction, they had already split up at this point, but there was this guy named Niall Horan. And I was like, I have to meet him. I have to get his autograph. I want to get a picture of him. And so I lined up and I waited. I got to the barricade and the red carpet show starts. And the celebrities come up in these big limousines or these really big cars and they get out and it's like mayhem. And girls are screaming, girls are crying. We happened to be standing right where the celebrities would stop and be interviewed by the talk show host before entering into the award show. And so if you can see here, there's a platter of chicken right in front of Joe Jonas's face. And that is because we lined up for so long that we were able to get the best spot on the red carpet where they were being interviewed right in front of us. And the TV show host gave this celebrity named Joe Jonas a platter of chicken during her segment, and he gave it to us. And so Joe Jonas gave me a piece of chicken, which I don't think many people can say, but Joe Jonas gave me a personal piece of chicken from his plate, and he shared his food with me. And finally, the time comes around where they obviously save the best celebrities, the most anticipated celebrities for last, and it was Niall Horan from One Direction, this little Irish blonde boy. And I was so excited. And so he comes, and he gets out of his car, and screaming and crying just blows up all across the red carpet. And girls are starting to run and push up against the barricades. And he gets out, and he's saying hi to all these different crowds, and he's giving autographs, and he completely passes my section. He goes to every single section on the red carpet but the one that I was at. So I managed to snag a picture of him. I couldn't find it, but I did get a picture of him. But the process that it took for me to get that picture was ridiculous. What happened was that since he didn't come to our section of the red carpet, all the girls, probably like 70 girls in my section, start climbing up the lampposts. And so girls are hoisting their friends up on their backs to try and get a view of him because they can't see him because there's so many people on, like, in front of the barricades, so they can't see them. We're teenage girls. Not all of them are really tall. And so they're starting to climb up the lampposts. And there was girls who were like climbing up the lampposts and with their phones trying to get a picture of him. And it was craziness. And he walked right by us, and I had a video going, so I had a video of him just zoop, just running right by us. And I felt satisfied. But after we left and they dismissed the red carpet because the show was starting and they were like, okay, guys, it's time to go home, there were girls crying on the streets because they didn't get an autograph with him. Girls sitting on the curbs being like, we lined up for hours for an autograph, and he didn't even come and say hi. And girls were in tears, calling their mom, being like, I didn't get to meet him. And girls were so upset. Isn't it crazy, the emotional reactions that arise when people see celebrities they love? Or even sometimes celebrities they hate. There comes and it evokes this emotional reaction in some people when they dislike certain celebrities. They might throw things at them or hurl insults at them. It's crazy how quickly public opinion can change. One minute you're excited because you're going to meet Niall Horan, and the next minute you're crying saying, he's so rude, he didn't even come over and say hi to me. One minute everyone loves a celebrity, and then the next they're publicly shaming them all over the internet. It's Palm Sunday this morning, and it's the beginning of what many Christians call Holy Week, which is essentially just the final days of Jesus' life before he goes to the cross to die for us and then resurrects from the dead. And this Holy Week opens with Palm Sunday, where Jesus enters into Jerusalem, knowing what awaits him in a mere 5 days, and he's greeted by this large crowd. This crowd who is rejoicing over his arrival. They're swarming around him, praising him for who he is, laying their coats down, laying palm branches down for him. And then only 5 days later, the same group of people, the same faces in the crowds that were praising him, are now crying out for him to be crucified. How quick can public opinion change? It's interesting how fickle the human heart really is. And so my message title for this morning is Behold, Welcoming the King. And that is exactly what Palm Sunday is all about. It's this triumphant entry of Jesus fully being recognized as the true King, the true Messiah who has come to bring salvation. And so if you have your Bibles with you this morning, I would like to invite you to turn to Luke chapter 19, verses 28 to 40. And we're going to be reading about this triumphant entry of Jesus as Messianic King. And so while you're flipping there, before we dive into this passage, it's important that we have some understanding of what happened in the days leading up to Palm Sunday, the days leading up to Jesus entering into Jerusalem. And so the night before Jesus is to go into Jerusalem for what is now called Palm Sunday, Jesus was in a town called Bethany and had dinner with his friends Mary, Lazarus, and Martha. And this is the story where Mary, maybe you're familiar with it, she takes her alabaster jar, which contains this incredibly expensive oil or perfume called nard that was typically used as a woman's dowry, or sometimes it was referred to as her inheritance. It's basically her life savings. It is what she has to live off of. If a woman at that time didn't have a dowry, they wouldn't be able to get married. They wouldn't be able to have livelihood. And so here is Mary with her alabaster jar, this dowry of hers, and she breaks it at the feet of Jesus. She smashes it on the ground, and she anoints him with this expensive oil. And this was essentially her inheritance. And she gives this sacrifice of giving her dowry, of giving this really luxurious, expensive oil and perfume to Jesus. And Judas, one of the disciples, he responds and he questions Jesus, saying, "Why are you letting her do this? Why are you letting her waste this oil? We could sell it and then donate this money to the poor. Why are you letting her do this, Jesus?" And Jesus responds and says, "Leave her alone, because it was always intended that Mary would save this perfume, this oil, for the day of my burial." And he says, "You will always have the poor, but you will not always have me." And that whole situation happens on the evening before Jesus is to enter Jerusalem on what we call Palm Sunday. And here is Mary anointing him with this incredibly expensive oil. And this oil, this what was called pure nard or nard, was typically only used on the night before a bride's wedding or to anoint the dead before burial, because it was an expensive oil. It was what we would consider the Tiffany of diamonds. That was how they would look and refer to this oil, as it was the oil of all perfumes, like the most expensive one you could have. And Jesus is being anointed with this oil. And this symbolic, but yet very real way of him knowing that he's now entering the week of his burial. He is now entering the week of his death. He knows what lies before him in the days to come. He says that you will always have the poor, but you will not always have me, because Jesus knows that in the next week, he will be arrested and tried, tortured, and eventually crucified. And so there's this heaviness to the story. Yes, we rejoice, because Palm Sunday is the realization that Jesus is our true Messiah, our true King who has come to save us. But there's also this understanding that Jesus knew what had to happen in the coming days. And while the crowds are rejoicing of his arrival, and they're laying palm branches down and they're celebrating, Jesus knows that he is soon to be crucified. and soon to become the suffering servant for our salvation. And so with that story, with that image in mind, let's read from Luke chapter 19, starting in verse 28. And so after Jesus had said this is referring to him talking to his disciples, he went on ahead going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.' Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying this colt?' And they replied, 'The Lord needs it.' And they brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. And as he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. And when he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully praising God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' 'I tell you,' he replied, 'if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out.'" Let's pray. God, we thank you that you are our true King. God, and as we reflect on Palm Sunday and this arrival of Holy Week, Lord, of you entering Jerusalem, Lord, knowing what laid before you, God, we thank you. God, we thank you that you are King of all kings, that you are Lord of all lords. And even though this crowd recognized you as just an earthly king, we know today, Lord, that you are our heavenly King. God, that you are the King of our heart. And so, Lord, we ask that you would give us wisdom and a sensitivity to your spirit, Lord, as we dive into your word and learn about you. God, we love you and we thank you. In your name, amen. Amen. So here is Jesus requesting that his disciples find this colt, or sometimes it's referred to as a donkey in the other gospel accounts. And he says, "Bring it to me." And this donkey, or this colt, is quite significant because in the culture at the time, getting an unridden donkey was often referred to as this practice of impressment, which is where the subjects of a king would be expected to make resources available for the king's use. And so Jesus is telling his disciples, go find me this colt that is unridden. And the fact that this donkey was to be unridden, or this colt was to be unridden, is to represent its purity and its appropriateness for a king. It has never been ridden before. And so the subjects are going to collect this unridden, this pure donkey so that the king could use it. And interestingly, in the ancient Middle Eastern world, kings or leaders would ride horses if they were riding into war, but they would ride donkeys if they came in peace, which we see talked about in 1 Kings 1, verse 33, where Solomon rides a donkey on the day that he was recognized as Israel's new king to represent that he was coming in peace, not in war. So here is Jesus riding on this donkey that has never been ridden, symbolizing its purity for a king and its how it's fitting for a king. And he's riding into Jerusalem, and this actually fulfills a prophecy of the coming Messiah in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9 to 10, which it should be on the slides. It says, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth." And Jesus perfectly fits this description of this king: righteous and victorious, lowly, or in some translations it says gentle. Rather than riding into Jerusalem to conquer it, He entered in peace, which verse 10 of Zechariah talks about. This king, this messianic savior, came to proclaim peace to the nations. Now, this was not what the Jewish people were looking for or even remotely wanted. They did not want a peaceful Messiah. They wanted a conqueror. The crowd that surrounded Jesus as he entered Jerusalem understood that he was the Messiah. He was to save them. But they expected him to politically save them from Roman rule, not spiritually save them. And we know that the crowd understands that Jesus is this Messiah, because in the other gospel books, we see the crowd laying palm branches down and their cloaks down as Jesus enters into the city, and they cry out, "Hosanna! Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And that wasn't just any ordinary phrase. That was not an ordinary greeting that they would give. This is the kind of welcome that was only reserved for Israel's Savior. The word Hosanna in Hebrew translates to save now. It means save now. It was a cry for help. They're crying, "Hosanna, save us." They're crying to the Messiah, asking him to save them from the persecution, from the weight of Roman rule. And along with the words Hosanna, the crowd is also recalling a verse in Psalm chapter 118, which says, "The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you." And this psalm, so Psalm 118, was often known or referred to as a psalm that rejoices in the Lord's triumph. It's the launch, the definition of the day of salvation. It's the rejoicing that their long-awaited deliverance has finally arrived, and it was reserved solely for Israel's Savior. And so the fact that the crowd is reciting this and they're crying out to Jesus saying, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," is them directly stating that Jesus is this long-awaited Savior of Israel, that he is their Messiah. And the crowd is giving Jesus this royal welcome. They're laying their cloaks down before him, laying palm branches, which at the time represented goodness and victory, and they're laying them down saying, "The victory is ours because the Messiah has come to save us." And they're rejoicing because they believe in their heart of hearts that they are going to be liberated and that they are going to be saved by this Messiah. And the crowd so boldly calling Jesus the Messiah, saying, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." It angered the Pharisees who were present. And the Pharisees are trying to get Jesus to make the crowd stop. And they're asking him to rebuke the people for saying that he is this blessed king. But Jesus refuses. Jesus responds to the Pharisees' cries in anger and says, "Even if they kept quiet, the rocks would still cry out." And Jesus is essentially saying that their rejoicing should be encouraged and not silenced. This joy they feel is so appropriate and so timely that even if they were to be suppressed and be forcibly quiet, even inanimate objects would cry out and declare that Jesus is this blessed king in order to fill this void of silence. Even the rocks would cry out, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And the thing is, though, is that this rejoicing did not last very long. It was very short and very brief. In 5 days after Palm Sunday, after this rejoiceful entry into Jerusalem, the same crowd who was crying out for this Messiah to save them would be the same crowd crying out 5 days later that Jesus is a blasphemer and should be crucified, that he is not who he says he really is. And like I said earlier, this crowd of people that surrounded Jesus as he entered into Jerusalem and laid out the palm branches and their cloaks before him, they understood that he is the Messiah. But what they didn't realize is that he was not going to look like the Messiah that they had been picturing for generations. The crowd wanted Jesus to set up this earthly kingdom that they had been promised, where they would be liberated and set free. But they didn't understand that it was not time yet, even though Jesus tries to tell them so in Luke chapter 19. He tries to say it's not time for the kingdom to be set up. But they didn't understand that. And the crowds wanted Jesus to be this Messiah that would rescue them politically and free them nationally. They wanted a battle, a war against the Romans. They wanted this Messiah to march into this city, to march into Jerusalem and liberate them. They wanted to be free from oppression, even if it meant by force. They wanted a Messiah who would restore to them what they would call the dominion of their land and would give them rule over the surrounding nations. That is the Messiah. That is the king that they had been waiting for, was this forceful earthly king. But Jesus did not come to be king of their land. He came to be the king of their hearts. He did not come to bring political or national salvation. He came to bring mankind's primary need, spiritual salvation. Jesus didn't come to set up a new political system that would benefit just the Jews. He came to change our hearts and save us from our sins. Jesus intentionally did not enter Jerusalem on a war horse, riding in on a horse, declaring that he's going to conquer Rome and he's going to liberate the Jews. He was not ready for conquests or for war. Jesus came riding into Jerusalem on a donkey as a symbol of peace. He came to bring salvation, not through physical conquest, but through suffering, through sacrificing his own life. And for centuries, Israel had awaited the coming of their king, to behold him, to be liberated under his rule. But this king was nothing like what they wanted. And on that day, as Jesus entered into Jerusalem, they shouted for joy, but completely missed the true reason of Jesus' arrival. They saw this king, this savior, face to face, but didn't recognize him for who he truly is, the savior of our soul. It says in Luke chapter 19 that this grieved Jesus' heart so much that he actually wept. In verse 41, it says, it'll be on the screen, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. And this cry that the scripture talks about is not this normal cry that you might be thinking of. The Greek word for weeping describes an intense sobbing, the type of weeping that overcomes you to the point where you lose control and begin loudly sobbing. And here is Jesus, and he's looking down over Jerusalem mess. He's preparing to enter in, knowing that there are multitudes of crowds ready to give him this royal welcome and praise. And he's weeping. He's weeping moments before he enters in, because he knows that the crowds are going to completely miss the whole point and purpose of his arrival. And Jesus, he gives us two reasons for this weeping. And the first is that the people would miss out on the peace that was right in front of them. The crowds wanted Jesus to bring peace through war, through defeating the Romans. That's how they would have their peace, is that the Romans had to be out of the picture and then everything would be peaceful. But what they didn't realize is that he came to bring eternal peace. The Prince of Peace was standing right in front of them. He arrived on a donkey, symbolizing he was to bring peace, and they missed it. The crowds acknowledged him as a human king who would bring them to victory, their human Messiah, but completely missed that he is the King of Kings, that he is God, our Savior. And the second reason for this weeping is that the people would face a future judgment, the people as being the people in Jerusalem. Jesus prophesies in that moment of the city's future doom, all because they did not recognize the true purpose of the arrival of their Messiah. And the generation that followed this crowd that swarmed Jesus on Palm Sunday, and the generation following them, so their children and their grandchildren, a Roman general would come and would eventually surround the city of Jerusalem. They would barricade the Jews in the city until they were famished from starvation. Then their armies would rush in and slaughter thousands of them. And this is referred to in history as the Great Siege of 70 AD. And the city of Jerusalem was burned to the ground. One generation after Jesus was there on Palm Sunday entering the gates of Jerusalem, and they're crying, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And they missed it. And because of it, they were judged. They did not recognize that God in the flesh was standing right before them. And so here is Jesus weeping over the fate of these people who he loves, who proclaim that he is the Messiah, but they would not believe that he is the King of Kings. The same people who were crying out, "Hosanna, save us," were the same ones to cry out, "Crucify him," just 5 days later. And this triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem actually foreshadows the final entry when Jesus will return. But when Jesus returns, this entry will look very different compared to Palm Sunday. It says in Revelation that when Jesus comes again, a new Jerusalem will come down out of heaven, and Jesus will be riding in on a horse, not a donkey. Jesus will come and bring judgment to this world, and instead of bringing peace, he will bring war against the rulers of darkness, which it says in chapter 19 of Revelation, verses 11, all the way to chapter 21, verse 5. Instead of coming in on a donkey, there will be a day where Jesus will return on that horse to defeat darkness once and for all. And there will be a day, we sang about it, there will be a day where every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And the Apostle John, he writes in Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, and he says, "After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hand. And they cried out in a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.'" They will hold palm branches in their hands. just like on Palm Sunday. But instead of these half-hearted shouts of joy and victory, in heaven it will be much different. These shouts of joy and of salvation, these shouts in praise that we have been saved, will be fully understood and those who declare the truth, that salvation belongs to our God, and that Jesus Christ, this one true King, is the one who freely gives us this salvation. That is the heavenly picture of what Palm Sunday should and could have been if this crowd recognized Jesus for who he truly is. And we will behold him. Every nation, every tribe and tongue will behold him in heaven and see him for who he truly is. We will see him rightly in all of his fullness. And yes, the day will come that Jesus will usher in judgment and will bring war against the rulers of darkness. But that's not something we should be afraid of, because that day has not yet come. As believers, we are given the assurance of knowing that we will be with Jesus when he returns. And for those of you who are like, I don't believe in Jesus, I don't follow Jesus, I'm going to be judged and there's going to be a war, you also don't really have to worry, because that day has not yet come. The day of salvation is now. Jesus has come to bring eternal peace, eternal life, a life that is abundantly full of joy and hope now. And in the days leading up to his death and eventually his resurrection, Jesus knew what was to come. And he didn't back out, and he didn't cower. He knew the price to be paid, and he willingly did it. Jesus willingly took our place. And it says in the Bible that the penalty for sin is death. And there is not a single person besides Jesus who is perfect, who is without sin, who is blameless. We could never save ourselves. As much as we try, as much as we think that I don't need a savior, as much as we believe that being a good person is enough, our lives are broken. My life was broken before Jesus. And to personally know that, on that Sunday, as Jesus entered into Jerusalem, he knew what awaited him. He knew the suffering he would endure. He knew the betrayal he would experience. He knew the heavy reality that his death would not be easy. But yet he didn't shy away from it. He entered into Jerusalem knowing what laid before him. We were talking in our youth ministry actually just this past Friday about how Jesus is the only God who saves us by suffering. There is no other God that brings himself so low to suffer for his followers, for his people, in order to save them. In nearly every other religion, the gods expect the people to earn their salvation, do good deeds, bring good sacrifices, uphold every religious law, be good people, and that might get you saved. But Christianity is the only religion. Jesus is the only God who does the opposite of that. There is no good deed that is good enough, and no good sacrifice we could bring that would satisfy the weight of our sin. We are not perfect. We can't uphold perfectly every single religious law. We are flawed. We need a savior. And Jesus knew this. He is the only God who saves us by taking the place we deserved and choosing to suffer in order for us to be set free. No other religion does that. There's not a single world religion besides Christianity where the God willingly chooses to suffer to save his people. And the reason why I say this is because in the Bible, Jesus, it says that he empathizes with our weaknesses in Hebrews. He is the only God who understands what it is like to suffer. He is a God who has wept, who bleeds. Jesus knows what living is like. He's familiar with the emotions we feel. He knows what it is to suffer, to grieve. The God I believe in, the Jesus that I follow, I can confidently say he is not a distant God. He's not the type of God where you must perform certain religious rituals in order to approach him, to talk to him. He's not the type of God who turns his face from us. I wholeheartedly believe this is not a dead religion. As heavy as this week is, knowing what lies before us on Good Friday, knowing what Jesus endures on the cross, knowing that he suffered, that the same people who shouted for joy at his arrival are the same ones who spat at him and mocked him. Even despite all of the heaviness, there is so much beauty and hope knowing that Jesus is risen and he is our victorious King. As followers of Jesus, we know how this story ends. We know that death is not the end, not for us and not for Jesus. We know that death has no longer has its power, that the grave is empty and the grave has lost. That we don't believe in a dead God, but a God who is alive, who is the keeper of peace, the King of all kings, the ruler of every living thing. And that is great news. That is such great news. If I could invite the worship team to come up. Let us not be like the people in the crowd who celebrated the coming of the Messiah, but actually missed the whole point of Jesus coming to save us from the weight and punishment of sin. Let's not be like this crowd who cried, "Hosanna, save us now. Blessed are you, God." And then 5 days later, they turn their backs and say, "Actually, I don't know you. Yes, I was saying just 5 days ago that I want you to save me, but I don't know you," because that's what the crowd is saying. And I'm going to follow what the crowd says, and I'm going to say, "No, crucify him." Let us not be like that. You know, the cross was meant for me. That grave that he laid in was meant for me. I praise God that on that Sunday, today, when Jesus entered into Jerusalem, that he willingly knew in a few days he would be sacrificed to save me, to save you. As Christians, we often want to rush through all the heaviness, and we just want to get straight to the joys of the resurrection. We often don't like sitting in the heaviness of knowing that Jesus took our place, that we were undeserving of the sacrifice he made. It's incredibly uncomfortable to be faced with the reality that Jesus died a brutal death in order to redeem us and free us from the bondage of sin. Jesus knew what was awaiting him, and he didn't turn the other way and flee from Jerusalem. He went straight into it, knowing what would happen. It's important that we acknowledge that our King, the one that we behold, our Savior, was a suffering Savior, a suffering servant. And that road to Calvary, that road to the cross, begins today on Palm Sunday. The days leading up to the cross were not easy for Christ. In fact, I would argue that they got more and more intense as he approached Friday, as he knew tomorrow is the day. There's two more days and this is happening. And the anticipation weighed on him, I can only assume. But he didn't waver. He didn't try to get out. He knew what was to happen. Jesus came to liberate you, to set you free from the slavery of sin, the bondage that binds us all. He came to give you peace, not this temporary peace that the world gives, that we often think about or accredit to being peaceful, but a steadfast peace that never wavers. He came to give you abundant life, not just a regular life, but life in abundancy, a life that is full of the hope and the joy that comes when we follow and trust Him to be Lord, to be King of our lives. And I want to invite you today. I know that Good Friday is going to be really evangelism focused, and so is Easter, but today is still the day of salvation. Don't wait till Easter Sunday if you are here. Don't wait till Good Friday to make the decision to follow Jesus. Today is the day of salvation. This whole week, in essence, is really at its core about salvation. And so if you are sitting here this morning saying, yes, I need God, I want to invite you to take that step. And I would love to pray with you. If you came here with a friend or family member, even just turning to them and saying, hey, I want to make that choice to follow God, to have Him be King of my life, I guarantee you the person that brought you here this morning would love to pray with you. And so the altar is open. If you would like prayer, it can really be about anything. I know we had a message that was really focused in on the salvation that God brings. And yes, the salvation God gives us is spiritual salvation, but that doesn't mean that He doesn't come to save us from a lot of other things as well. He comes to give us hope, to heal us, to provide a purpose in our lives. Yes, the cross, the whole purpose of it is to save us from the weight of sin. But we can come to Jesus with every single need that we have. And so maybe you're saying, I already believe in God and I don't need to make that commitment to follow Him again. But there's something laying on you this week that you just feel like you need prayer for. And it doesn't have to be anything related to the message. I would love to pray with you. This side of the altar is open if you specifically want prayer. And if you are just wanting to respond to God, maybe the Holy Spirit has laid something on your heart, has convicted you of something, whether it's about making Jesus a priority in your life. Oftentimes, Palm Sunday for me always makes me reflect on, am I being like the people in the crowd who said, Hosanna, come save me, and then a couple days later betrayed Him? Sometimes we have to do a heart check and ask ourselves, am I just going along with what everyone believes, or do I really believe for myself that Jesus is my King, that He is my Savior? And so we're going to move into a time of response. And like I said, if you would like prayer, this side of the altar is open. If you would just like to respond, and sometimes coming up to the altar is a way to symbolize surrender to God, this side of the altar is open, and I invite you to stand as we sing. We're going to be singing a song about the majesty of God. And the whole point of Palm Sunday is that Jesus is our true King. He is the King of Kings. We behold Him. He is everything. And so as we respond, I invite you to just allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you as we sing.
Here I am, humbled by your majesty, covered by your grace so free. Here I am, nowhere.
God, we thank you that you are our King, Lord. God, that you are not just King of this earth, Lord. You are King of our lives, King of our heart, oh God. That you are the King of kings, God, the Lord of lords. That there is no other God that compares to you, God. There is no other God like you. God, that you would come knowing what awaited you in 5 days, Lord, knowing that you would suffer and choosing to do so to save those who were not deserving, God. But still, you did it. Still, you came, you suffered, you died in order for us to be set free, in order for us to be redeemed, to be freed from the bondage of sin, God. Only you, Jesus, could do that. And we thank you, God. God, as we enter into this week, Lord, knowing that you will soon go to the cross and then you will soon be risen. God, we thank you. We thank you. God, we thank you for taking our place. God, there is no words that can express or articulate the gratitude that we have for what you have done. So God, I ask that you would be with us, Lord, even in this week, God, that you would help us remember and reflect, oh God, on the work of the cross, oh God, on the week, on the days leading up to your death and resurrection, God. Holy Spirit, would you help us, Lord, to be mindful of what you have done, God, that it would not be something we take for granted, Lord. God, that we would fully appreciate and be full of gratitude for all that you have done and all that you are still doing, Lord. And God, we rejoice in the fact that if we put our trust in you, God, that we will be with you in heaven. God, that we will see you rightly for who you truly are. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. God, we bless your name. We thank you for who you are and all that you have done. God, would you be with us throughout this week, Lord? God, keep us safe and healthy and strong as we go from here, oh God. God, and even for Good Friday and Easter, God, that you would help us to invite our friends and our family, God, to receive this opportunity, God, to know you and to love you and to follow you. God, we give you all the glory in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, church, it has been so great to worship with you this morning. Be blessed as you head home for the week. We hope to see you on Good Friday for our service, as well as Easter Sunday. Just a reminder, there is no cafe downstairs. And if you are here for our ABM meeting, it should be happening shortly following the service. Have an awesome week, everyone. Be blessed. Take care.